about. We have the four people. I'll quickly tell you who they are and what they do. And the three over there are all entrepreneurs. They've started tech companies. They've been funded. They're just remarkable work that they're doing. They'll introduce themselves. There's Sneha, Priya, Piyush, Agrawal, Jairaj, Bhattacharya. They'll introduce, it'll use a 2-minute, 3-minute video.
Over millions and millions of engineers are literally manufactured in universities all over the world, supplied with only theoretical learning and no real substance. And when they leave college and go to the real world, they settle for mediocre jobs. But what if you grow up doing something different? Seeing everything technically, understanding and passion for engineering fundamentals. Wouldn't this mold you into a future innovator? How far can you go? Robotics and automation is the future, and that's not even a bit of hyperbole. Robotics and IoT will be integrated into nearly every aspect of most people's daily lives. From farming to pollution, our products help you to get the hands-on experience on all the latest technologies with an ease of learning them from anywhere. And sky is the limit. Now, what are you waiting for? Discover your strengths, showcase your talents, and become the future innovator. Join the SBRW Tech community. There's a difference.
So this is what we're all about. So we are all ages, right from 11-year-olds to 60-year-olds, who are all experiencing the different technologies, the latest technologies. So all of us know how fast technology is growing nowadays. Today you have a technology which is outdated in just 3 months. So that's the speed at which the education system should also grow, but sadly that's not happening. So we wanted to create a path or access to people to get these technologies, to understand these technologies in a practical way, gain the skills and be ready for the jobs that are there outside. So that's exactly what we wanted to do. So we have a series of hands-on kits in different technologies, robotics, IoT, Internet of Things, and we're coming up with VR, ROS, and the other latest technologies which are used in the industries outside. And these kits can be learned completely from the basics on an online platform. We have a very extensive LMS system which helps people to learn from the basics. It interacts with them, it finds out if they're able to understand or not, explain the concept again and again, just like a physical teacher. So all this is done, and finally we track the skill sets. For example, you're doing robotics. Robotics is a mix of everything. It has electronics in it, it has mechanical, it has programming, everything. So there might be a lot of engineers out here. I'm also an engineer. I took up a particular field called electrical just because someone else told me. And that's what everyone in India is doing. So we wanted to change that as well. So we started tracking the skills of people when they're doing all this experiment. Let it be 11-year-old or let it be even 24-year-old.
We want to let me understand. So kids,
yes,
that kids can use with help from online.
Exactly.
Okay.
So it is not just, you know, the kit and the learning alone.
Right.
We wanted it to be an overall education system,
right,
rather
it's much broader than that.
Yes. So rather than just a training.
Okay.
Training is you use something, you get a certificate, you close it.
So who's your customer basically?
We have schools, two students are the majority today. We have college. We have even companies like Tech Mahindra and other people who get this to train their R&D.
So a school would buy a whole bunch of kits that you have produced?
Yes, the schools buy. We sell it online as well.
Okay.
So people can buy it online and read from their home.
And then they can go online and look at some instruction for how to use the kits.
Yes. So there's detailed animation-based videos which explain them and all.
I understand. And so school systems might buy. Can an individual parent buy? Can a parent buy?
A parent can buy it.
How much does it cost? How much?
It starts from about 6,500 rupees.
Wow. Okay.
So and goes to about 15,000. There are different levels of kits.
And what would a company? You said you mentioned companies might buy. What would they do with it?
They train their R&D people. For example, IoT. which is coming new to a market.
Kind of
they want their people to get skills.
I see.
So they are using these kits to get them.
So basically you started with kits and then we added more services and a broader market as well. So that's great. Thanks a lot. We'll come back to you. This is a company called Super-Profs. He's the CEO of Super-Profs.
Network was founded in 2010 with a vision. Of making quality education accessible to a wider audience at affordable prices. Aorus Network has subsequently established itself as a leading technology provider to the online education sector, with multiple institutions around India using their solutions to deliver content securely, reliably, and scalably. The core management team have wide experience from some of the world's top academic institutions and technology companies. This know-how leads to pioneering advances in the application of technology to solve real-world challenges.
Clearly, the classical way education and learning has happened is going to go through a dramatic change. Instead of bringing students to education, can we bring education to students?
The key service offerings are Course Hub and Superprofs.com.
The unique thing about it is that we can deliver the HD-like quality at a really very low bitrate, and it is highly secure and scalable.
It's a very focused technology solution put in the hands of outstanding professors so that they can now deliver their wonderful courses, not just to a handful of students who are sitting before them, but to a much larger audience.
A range of prestigious institutions have already trusted Aorus Network with delivery of their educational content, thereby increasing the number of students they can teach.
We are also having a very good platform to deliver our skills, not to a limited set where we are sitting here today. We have become popular all across the country. Everybody knows us.
Aorus Network prides itself on the capability and experience of the team they have built. Aorus Network.
Sorry for the long video, actually, I just thought I will stop here. So I think as the video mentioned, my name is Piyush Agrawal and I'm one of the co-founders of this company called Aorus Network. And this was started in 2010 and towards this larger goal actually, when we started this company, we realized that there are three main challenges which we face in a country like India. The first challenge is the bandwidth challenge or the accessibility challenge, that which means that if you have great quality content, how do you make that content available on all kind of networks or all kind of devices? So that was one challenge. The other challenge was how do you create the content itself? How do you make a conventional teacher comfortable with technology so that he can be teaching not only to say a 50-60 student classroom but to a much larger set of students? And thirdly, how do we empower the teachers into being better at teaching using data and analytics? So towards this, we built a compression technique which was very, very specific for Indian ecosystem, where we were able to deliver high quality, HD quality videos at very slow internet speeds, as low as 100 kilobits per second. So a regular 2G connection is all you would require to watch a HD quality video on a mobile device or a desktop. Secondly, we also developed a completely automated lecture capture system using off-the-shelf Android devices, which can capture any classroom in a high quality without the teacher requiring to modify his way of teaching. And this is a very automated system which makes sure that the cost of building the content is very low. Thirdly, we built data analytics engine where we empowered the teachers with a lot of data about how the students are reacting to what they are teaching and how much they are actually able to understand or not understand, so that they can improve their teaching style.
So Piyush, from what I remember you telling me, you're providing a lot of instruction for folks who are preparing for the CPA kind of CA market.
Yeah. So what we did was that after developing these three, I would say, pillars actually, we realized that in the overall education market, there is school education, there is higher education, and then there is this test prep or professional education where a lot of students are trying to prepare for exams like chartered accountancy, civil services, IIT, GAIN and all. And there is an acute shortage of good teachers for these exams who are generally only available in Windows. So we use the same technology platforms that we built to power up Super-Profs.com, which has today become a fairly large platform with 1.5 million students using it on a monthly basis from 600 cities, towns and places across the country. How much do they pay? So they, on an average, a student would be paying something around 10 to 20,000 rupees a day.
10 to 20,000 rupees. Okay. So it's 100 to $300. And each student stays with you about, and this is in a year.
Yes, that's correct.
And so they would stay with you for like a couple of years?
So actually, you know, exams like CA, a student has to typically do it over a period of 5 years. So okay. Getting for the Indian civil services exam, it's a never ending journey, right?
So do you mind sharing what your revenues are? Is that
part of absolutely. So we're doing roughly around $1 million in revenues.
Okay.
And, I think the more interesting part for me is that we have been able to do this profitably.
Yeah.
We reached here, you know, in a very frugal manner, you know, with very good implementation.
Right. And you've been through how many rounds of funding?
We reached 2 rounds of funding.
Okay.
One from Indian Angel Network, Mr. Sharad Sharad.
Sure, sure.
In there, and the other one from Citizen
Investor. Okay. We'll come back to some other questions you might have for Sneha also. And why don't we move on to Jairaj? And his company is ConveGenius, and they make curated content which they put on tablets.
As a child, I was very afraid of mathematics, and I did not want this thing to travel to my children. From the very beginning, I was searching for something where my children learn problem solving, their skills, their concepts related to maths and English are very, very clear. And I came across using this book.
Mothers who are sit-at-home mothers are able to make income out of our platform. So we at ConveGenius, we have developed a platform called CD Slave, where we curate and aggregate content and potentially acquire content partners. And we are building a platform which focuses on learning, essentially something, we're trying to do something like the Netflix for learning, where we focus on learning enhancement from a child's perspective. In terms of understanding where the child is weak at, what the child's strengths are, and adapting and creating the right content interface and the learning journey for the child based on the child's requirements. So how we do that is essentially we are building an intelligent system which basically aggregates content which is being created by multiple content partners and pedagogy experts across India and the globe. We take the content either in the offline format or in the digital format, and we seamlessly onboard it onto our platform and tag it with various learning competencies and parameters. And the content is then consumed by the end user, either through the tab or the teacher can print it and create activity sheets out of it. So we have a very rigorous module where a teacher could just use our platform and kind of start teaching, and a student could potentially self-learn. So the whole idea is to empower various institutions with a learning enhancement solution which showcases content through tabs, through TV, television, device agnostic, and also potentially you can print it if you have a printer at home and start a income generation solution. It costs about 2,000 rupees per year. So if you buy the SD card, and some of the institutions or schools are also doing streaming, where you are not even buying the SD card, you just download the app on a device and you can stream, and that goes down to about 100 rupees a month.
And this content maps into the school curriculum as laid down by the government.
Yeah, so the way we have structured our solution is that it is mapped to any curriculum. It could be a CBSE, ICSE, a Rajasthan board, a Haryana board, any board. That board becomes an input parameter on what board you want the content on. And how the learning happens is skill-based. Although you are doing a grade curriculum, say grade 5 or grade 4, but the learning is essentially driven by learning competencies. So I might be doing grade 3, but I'm not at grade 3 level competency. In India, an average grade 5 student is two grade levels below. So in order to solve for that problem, the platform essentially back integrates through vertical integration. So if you're not doing good 3-digit multiplication, we go back and understand if they're able to do 1-digit multiplication. If not, we go back to addition.
You're doing this in school systems as well?
We are doing in school systems, we are doing with NGOs, CSRs and governments. So largely B2B.
So how many children have you touched so far?
We have touched 230,000 children across India in different languages.
So 230,000 children in all across India. How many institutions, how many schools?
So it would be hard to say the number of schools.
Okay.
But so we are in 20 states across India, and Hindi belt, we are in all across the Hindi belt, Rajasthan, Haryana, Himachal, in Maharashtra, in Marathi, Tamil Nadu.
And so I think that we now have a good sense of the basics of what these three youngsters are doing using technology in education. And you know, the reason for, I don't think technology can ever substitute for having a good classroom teacher, right? You learn through interactions, you learn through a human teacher and so on. But the question is, can we use technology to make the in-class teaching richer? Can we provide supplementary education? And can we reach those kids or adults who are not getting education at all? Can they benefit from using technology? So I'd like to turn the question into the next one. You know, Sneha, you're doing robotics, and Jairaj, you're doing tablets and education. Piyush, you're going to a higher segment, people preparing for the CA, CPA kind of exam, and you're all using technology. What are the opportunities you see? We are just at the beginning of a revolution in some ways. What are the opportunities you see, what are the challenges you see in using technology for having massive impact? You know, in India, we still have maybe 10% of the people who are illiterate, and then a whole bunch of people who are literate but functionally illiterate, which by the way is a problem all over the world. We have it in the US as well. You come out of high school and you can't really do much with your education sometimes. So what are your thoughts on this general question of technology and impact? And we can make this a conversation. Lalitesh, please jump in anytime. But let's just start with Sneha. You know, what are your thoughts on this?
Started it. So we started teaching robotics in a center where we used to have trainers. So we believed in the physical teacher being there and training. But when we wanted to scale and tackle to more students, make more innovators at different locations, we were not able to do it because we could not find the same quality trainers at all the locations. That was a major kickback in our scaling, whether it was reaching our goals. So that's when we rolled back and we started doing things online. So that's when we got the funding, we built the online platform. Now today it's not purely online as well, because as you rightly said, online only, if only if it is online, I can only reach the metro people. I cannot go a little more deeper. So the online learning in fact is not so popular even in the metro cities. People are still reluctant to go online and learn. So now we have moved to a different, a kind of hybrid model where we have maker labs. These maker labs can be set up in any location, and all you need is just a computer lab set up. So people will come, take the kit, use the computer, learn and go. So when you tell this, it's more or less like a browsing center kind of a model to look from the business perspective. But the quality of teaching remains intact here. You don't need a trainer anymore. At the same time, it's getting scaled up and we are able to reach out to a lot of masses.
So Sneha, remind me, I think you've talked about this before. So is this kind of a franchise setup?
Yes, this is a franchise setup. So we leave out franchise of Maker Labs, starting from just a few lakhs. You can just set up a Maker Lab at any location, which is 750 square feet. As I said, no technical trainer is required. You just need 10 computers to be set up there and a few of our kits, robotic kits.
How many such labs do you have?
We have about 15 right now, 15? Yeah, we just started 1 month back.
And the people who set up a lab like this, how much do they invest?
Right from say 5 lakhs to 10 lakhs.
Okay.
So that would be the initial investment required for the entire business.
And how soon do they break even?
They start getting the ROI from month 1 itself. The capital recovery happens in about 7 to 10 months depending on their performance.
So inside a year, I've paid back the money I've invested.
Yes.
Sounds like a great opportunity. Probably lots of people in the audience might be interested in this. But you said you don't need any training.
Yes. See, we wanted to make sure people did the business part. Because there are business people outside. There are people who are aspiring to be entrepreneurs outside.
Okay.
So we wanted them to take up this as a business and create more innovators along the way.
So do you see any possibility of penetrating rural India or small towns with this?
Definitely, definitely. That's one of the main reasons I wanted to be here.
So you're going to come and set up shop in Deshpande Foundation? And
definitely.
Okay.
Definitely.
Okay, great. Piyush, you want to?
Sure. We can use technology to achieve new things. I think I have a slight different observation, like on what Sneha mentioned. So in our case at Super-Profs, 70-80% of the students are actually coming from tier some kind of a job, or a lot of them are doing some articleship or internship or training actually. And for them to, and since they are based in tier 2, tier 3 towns, for them to prepare for these specialized exams like a chartered accountancy or the Indian Civil Services exam, it's impossible to relocate to metro cities like Delhi, right? And technology is playing a very important role in taking these teachers from metro cities who have been teaching for many years now. The technology is able to take their classrooms to students who are across the country, and they don't have to leave their job. They don't have to leave their college. They can be at home. I mean, we see students studying. The platform usage increases a lot in the evening hour or the night hours, actually, especially on the weekends. So we see a lot of people who cannot go for the conventional format of education. They were not part of the mainstream. They are now able to come and become a part of the mainstream because of technology. That's one of the biggest opportunity, and I think we have just scratched the surface actually, right? Because the population and the number of aspirants in the smaller towns is far bigger than in the metro cities. So I think if we are able to continue what we are doing, we see a huge opportunity there. Secondly, I think with technology, I have often seen that very few technical solutions are actually empowering the teachers, which is where I feel there is a huge gap actually. And there are multiple ways of doing that, but I think we need to seriously do some innovation in terms of how do we empower the existing teachers rather than trying to replace them. So I think it could be in the form of better data analytics, it could be a form of feedback on their teaching styles using some analysis and AI, or multiple opportunities are there. So these are all, I would say, areas where I would look for great opportunities.
Great. Jairaj, you want to give us your thoughts?
Yeah, so I'll start with first, can you hear me in the back?
Yeah. Maybe you can also stand up because people want to see who you are.
So I'll start with basically letting you know that we already have 40% of our user base in the rural India. And that's happened because we work in a partnership model. So essentially, we are a platform and there are multiple NGOs, CSR organizations, institutions taking our platform and using it. So the important part that I would like to highlight is technology by itself in a self-learning format doesn't work today. You have to use it in a blended format, which is guided learning. Essentially, there is a facilitator, if not a teacher, at least a facilitator, facilitating the classroom. And the content, access to content, quality content, and the learning enhancement can happen through technology. But the role of a teacher, which is the emotional quotient that a teacher adds to the classroom, that cannot be replaced. So saying that, what the model that we follow to enter rural India or even in urban slums is that we create tab labs in classroom. So tab labs are, one classroom is converted into a kind of a tab lab where there are tablets where students come and they log in, they have their own personal profile, and they learn in a guided, completely self-learning, individualized and personalized manner. So they have their own personal profile through which they continue to learn from where they had stopped earlier. So the way we have been able to show successful learning outcomes is kind of connecting the stakeholders involved, not just the student, but the student, the teacher, the parent and the administrator. And if the administrator is at a different level, it's the first the principal, then the say the government or the NGO administration. So how we do that is through data. Everything that the child learns, or the child has even come to the classroom, it's an attendance point. From attendance to engagement, and from engagement to learning outcomes. All this data from the tablet or the platform through which they are learning is going to the teacher in an analyzed manner that today these students are performing well, these students are below average, and these are a remedial path student, and you need to focus on these particular concepts. Similarly, the parent gets an SMS in their vernacular language that today your student, your son has completed fractions and has done that with 50%. So the parent is aware that the child is learning through the technology. And similarly, the administration gets detailed dashboards on real-time basis how their funds are going and impacting the student. So we're connecting all the stakeholders, the whole community gets aware about what's happening. That becomes powerful, and then this becomes, the parents come up with giving money, not a lot, even 200 rupees a month makes this a sustainable model for in a rural area. So these tab labs are very powerful in schools. We look at that as a very scalable model in the rural area.
Sure. I'm going to request Lalitesh to jump in with his thoughts rather than stay on to the end.
Enhancement is being measured. So in order to do that, we have created metrics both in content consumption and content application. So when a student is going through a learning journey, so they are consuming content through games, through videos, through books. So that's essentially you're grasping a particular concept. So in that, we have created tagging where pop-up quizzes come up in between, just to judge whether the learning is happening through that particular content or not. And then there is overall sub-competency level improvement tracking, which is essentially a pre-task and a post-task. During the learning journey, first we start with a pre-task where we see how much they know about that particular concept, and then there is a post-task after the learning journey happens where the delta of the improvement is taken. Apart from that, we have baselining and endlining through standardized assessments, which are already being taken by large organizations like GMI, Acer, on pen and paper. We have introduced these standardized assessments within the platform itself as a baseline, midline and endline in the overall year. So that gives a long-term, longitudinal journey. And what I get to see is that it is very much dependent on the implementation part of it. It's not like technology, just introducing technology will give the same results everywhere. So different programs have different improvements. And within the program, in different demographics, we see different kinds of data. So administration and operations become a very important role in how it is administered, whether the child is actually coming to the class. So the first step, as I was saying, is attendance, if the child is in the class or not. The second step is if the child is engaging with the content or not. Engagement, of course, can be improved by gamification that we have done in our platform. And the next step from engagement is learning outcomes. So it goes stepwise. So we also create our operational processes stepwise, that we get alerts and we give these alerts to the administration that this part of this area is not even using tabs. So forget about learning.
So I was just mentioning to Sneha before this event began that robotics was my first love. I was the aerospace student. Slightly frustrated aerospace student because my love was physics and computer science, which one of my teachers later told me, this was in 1989, when I was graduating from college, he said, by the way, what you've been doing for the last 3 years, I never told you, is robotics. So you should go find a degree in robotics. And by that time, it was too late to apply, so I spent 4 years hopping from college to college in the US until I found, at that point, the only place in the world which offered a degree in robotics. So Sneha, I had a question. The kind of training that you are trying to impart in robotics and in the other science, in the biological science, there is a similar revolution happening in the biotech space, in the genetic space and so on. And in the liberal and the social space, you need completely different frameworks to think through how you, do even basics of, the old style management needs to transform itself. Right, so all of the fundamental sciences we have relied on are changing. So you are embarking on ConveGenius. How receptive do you find a mainstream? I mean, obviously very well educated parents and so on will jump on it. I'm not worried about them. And young kids, of course, love this stuff. So I'm not also ask about them. I'm asking about the people who are entrenched in the existing paradigm, who will care a lot but might resist you. How are you dealing with that?
It's quite a big problem, actually speaking. People today, there are a lot of people in the college who in India, the engineering colleges are flooded. So, and when they come out, it's mostly IT. And now there is a kind of realization that people are going through in the IT sector that having only that skills is not going to lead them anywhere. People are getting the jobs, but they have started doing the extra stuff to make sure they're updated with the right skills. That realization has started slowly coming in. It's not predominant in all the regions, especially the practical learning importance is not predominant in all the regions. We bring it through telling people that these kind of jobs are being upgraded to a different level, just like how computer came and revolutionized the job sector. Robotics and automation is going to do the same thing. So we do that kind of awareness at different locations to tell people that you have to upgrade yourself. So that's something that we do to solve this.
Is it working?
Not entirely. I would say it's working 20%. So if there's a crowd of 100 people, I have 20 people come back and ask what to do next, maybe 10 people who take up the step and do it actually. So only 10% outcome is coming out at this moment. And still India is majorly having the manual labor in hand. So that is why this revolution is not happening at a very large scale. We need, probably in another 3 to 5 years down the line, people will have no other choice than moving towards it at that time.
So Piyush, you seem to have reached a very large number of older students, older in the sense that they're not school kids, this is a professional education. You know, we at the Deshpande Foundation are struggling with how do we respond to the massive need for skill development. And we feel that, especially when we get to rural India and tier 2, tier 3 cities, that there is a tremendous demand. Actually, finding skilled people is a challenge all over the world. There are studies done across the globe. And across the globe, they've interviewed companies and found that 50%, nearly 50% of jobs for skilled people go unfilled every year. This is a particularly serious problem in places like Japan, where it can be 70 or 80%, but it's all over the place. India is probably more like 50%. So we have all these youngsters looking for jobs, and they don't have the skills, and the companies have the opportunity. So do you think that your sort of way of reaching out and providing value for professionals can be also used for the massive demand for skill development, because we literally need couple hundred million people need to be upskilled?
So I think certainly there is a huge possibility of using the technology and what we have built in otherwise as well to true skilling and, you know, large scale skilling. I think there are two observations which I have, you know, where we, I think the problem lies in the way we are doing. There are a lot of organizations which are doing skill training today, but I think there are two major mistakes that we are making today. The first is in terms of how we are actually completing the loop. So, you know, we do a lot of trainings, but we pay very less attention about measuring the learning outcomes and at the right time actually. In most schools, colleges or training institutes, the general methodology is that you have some sessions for a month or a week and then you have an exam. And then that exam tells you that, okay, in your class, 30% people understood this, 50% didn't understand, or whatever statistics you get, right? But by the time the teacher is provided with that data, it's already too late actually, right? And after that, there is only catching up for the learner. What I believe is that I think learning and continuous evaluation have to go hand in hand, and technology can certainly play a major role there, right? And there is a lot of work which is happening in skill training, but I think until unless we tie that training with evaluation continuously during the learning and on during the job as well. A lot of the times we train people and then put them on job, but you ask them 3 months down the line, they would hardly remember anything actually, right? So I think that the reskilling part, the continuous evaluation part is something which is lacking today, which can be worked upon. The other opportunity I see is that, you know, there is so much of knowledge in the classrooms, and even today most of the organizations are not spending enough resources on digitizing that content or digitizing the training. I think a very simple thing that can be done is that all training sessions are at least recorded in video format, because then that becomes an asset for, you know, future batches and the same batch of the students who had undergone that training actually. And obviously this will not solve the problem of effectiveness. I think for solving the problem of effectiveness of training, you need to have, you know, more multimedia oriented content, more hands-on exercises. But even whatever is being learned, I feel that it has to be archived so that, you know, more people can be benefited from there, and these are very low hanging fruits, right? So two suggestions. One is in terms of digitization of the classroom content. Secondly, I think in terms of tying up learning and continuous evaluation, these are two major areas where I think we need to work.
Let me ask Piyush and Jairaj two tricky questions. Same tricky question to both of you. So both of you are using your online platform not just to teach but also to measure how much the student has learned. I'm not even asking how much they're improving, but at some point you have some metric that tells you how well the student has learned a particular topic. How confident are you of this measurement?
It's a very good question, and all my product team and my content team's energy is both in making this as valid as possible. So learning is core to our platform in terms of tracking learning.
Are you close enough? I mean, you have enough confidence to say that you're as good as an offline test?
We are using the offline test.
No, but
as a tool.
As a tool, even in your online measurement,
yeah.
Are you getting high enough confidence to say that you can replace the offline test?
We are doing better. I'll tell you why we are doing better. So the offline test essentially is a baseline pen and paper and then an endline pen and paper. So we start from there. The same baseline pen and paper is essentially being done online, introduced on the tab with the practice questions being solved on the book. But from there we get the data, the baseline, the same data that comes, the same formula, the same items are being used. But now we are doing something with that data. Now what we are doing is that the baseline gives us an initial learner profile of where, what the child is good at, what the child is, what weaknesses of the child are. So based on that data, we do vertical integration of concepts. These are the weak concepts of the child. So essentially, it goes back and the learning journey gets adapted accordingly. So we are doing better than the old pen and paper
and
style.
And if tomorrow, yeah, same thing happens. Let's suppose you have K to 10,
yes.
You have the 10th grade exam, right? And you have the CPA exam. Could you, if regulations allow, replace those exams?
I'll say I would love to.
Would you be able to?
So, you know, at least I believe that, you know, the assessments are pretty accurate in our case, because we do try to measure the correlation between the performance of the students on our online test. And in our case, the problem is easier because there is a standardized test, right? So our students are preparing for a CPA or a CA, and we do track the performance of these students in the official exam as well. And we have seen a very close correlation between their performance actually not only the performance in the exams, but they, even their usage of the content, how much interaction they had, then you know the performance on the assessments, and then the eventual performance on the main exam. And but I think, you know, more than these assessments, which are again, you know, I think what is more important is at a very concept level, you know, if we are able to say that whether whatever was taught to you in the last 30 minutes, that has been understood or not, that part is very important, and there are easy ways to measure that with in-video quizzes.
The reason I've been asking this question is that, you know, if you fast forward 20 years, where we are going to end up is we are going to end up in an exam-less world, right? Because you learn on the platform is doing both teaching and measurement, and by the end of it, at some point you will know that I have reached this level of math, this level of English, this level of science, and you, all of that you plug together into a, you know, meta certificate called it.
Very interesting question. Actually, one NGO I would like to mention is already doing that. What they have removed any kind of exam intervention, and our solution itself becomes a kind of a level-based scoring mechanism. So the, how do they do that is, since the tests are integrated as a part of an activity within the solution, as a part of the gamification, we are already getting data, and this data is being used to give certificates for the after-school remedial intervention. So it's about a 1 lakh children intervention that's happening.
So I have one, two comments. One is that I think you guys are playing small, because you are on to something much bigger than just teaching. You are on to the ability to replace this rat race of exams, because there is no reason why a bright student cannot get to a 10 standard math by level 7, and somebody else, you know, who may not be that interested in English can get to that level, you know, well, but meanwhile they can be learning other things, truly free something. And that brings me to the other comment, which is in the automation era that Sneha is talking about that we are heading into, no field will disappear. What will happen is only the top 5 or 10% of every profession will remain and thrive. So, and I'm not just talking about doctors and engineers, I'm talking about carpenters and, you know, gardeners and so on. Top 5 or 10% of every profession will thrive. And the answer to that, if you talk to any, you know, professor, my father was one, and Sushil is one, is that you follow your passion, right? Which is what this platform allows you to do. So I think they're at the brink of a revolution, and my suggestion is you guys are playing this one. You should aim to be the SATs and the ACTs of it.
So in that vein, I just want to make another comment, and I think that the way education is delivered is going to be unbundled and rebundled. So today we are stuck on undergraduate education is 3 years or 4 years, master's is 1 year or 2 year, and it's on particular topics and there's certain kinds of courses. But I think learning will become, you know, in the future you will have, there'll be competencies, there'll be skills that you will learn at different pace, and there'll be certification agencies who will certify you've got those. And you may not need a conventional undergraduate or conventional master's and so on. The job, the way education is defined will be completely different. And there again, as Lalitesh is saying, youngsters like you are going to see that and create that transformation. We have a few minutes left. I think we can probably go another 10 minutes, which gives us an opportunity for maybe 3 or 4 questions. The gentleman in the cap at the back, if you can shout.
Yeah, sure. Well, I'm from Lilly Foundation, and in the education field, we teach the kids, not the good kids, but really poor kids who get like 30 or 40 marks, and bring them up to a level where they can cross the wall of the secondary, upcoming exam, and higher secondary exam. Okay? So in that process, we definitely try to do a performance measurement, how they did at the time of admission and how they are doing now. Okay. But this is a very rudimentary process that we are following. I'm just taking the mark sheet at the time of entrance and make a percentage of that. And going out, I also make a percentage of that and I try to see. But my question is, do you know of any good performance measurement software that I can utilize for this?
There are multiple softwares available. You can use mine as well. But I would love to help you out with that.
Into that, you know, so we were talking yesterday that with the number of students we train, and we are also starting digitization of content. Jennifer here is leading that charge. We were together at IIM Bangalore. And we can actually do randomized control trials. So, you know, because we have enough students, so we create modules and we can test. And I think that, as Lalitesh is saying, you have to publish papers, create a brand name, because today there's the big brand universities and schools have a lock on the market. And as the unbundling and rebundling takes place, there has to be certification, branding, confidence building as well. So it's a long journey we're embarking on. Any other questions?
I'm Murli from Makalcharati. We work with government schools. We also believe, you know, technology is enhancing the quality as well as the scale. I appreciate all of your products. I have two concerns here. One is, as Jairaj said, the outcome is maybe 70% of the outcome is depending on how the implementation, right? So is there any processes, any strategies to ensure the implementation you guys is having? That is number one concern. Because it is 70% depending on that. And second thing, since technology, we always think for scalability. In Karnataka, we are around 69 to 70,000 schools, out of which around 50,000 schools are government schools. So when it comes to a scale and how these products really enables to a government schools children and the teachers. Because most of the people sitting here, I think, working with government schools. And because this, I can see many products coming out every other day in the market. But how is really reaching these kids? You know, then we can talk about really technology is helping reaching that, you know, mass. Thank you.
So I'll actually give you the answer through example of one of our interventions that we are doing with the Haryana government, with government schools. So you're right, technology just setting up the product in the government school will not solve the problem. We have to look at the intervention not just as a product being introduced or technology being introduced into the school, but it has to be a holistic program. So it's not the product, it's the program. So the program includes the implementation processes also as a part of the product. So when we introduce our solution on the ground, for example, in the Haryana government schools, we have a partner, Cavalier Foundation, who's helping us with the implementation. So that means that the whole implementation process, all the data that is coming in from the ground is going to a program manager every week. That these are the schools where attendance is a problem. These are the schools where engagement is not happening. There's some issue. And that driving, that program management is also a part of that. The product, as I said, so it is a part. It is a whole intervention that has to happen. And as I say, it is not infrastructure that we are deploying in the school. It is a program that is happening. So it cannot be looked at as a tablet being given to the children. It has to be a SaaS model. So essentially, we give out the tablets for free when we deploy it in a classroom. It is a SaaS model that that happens where it's an ongoing program that continues. That works.
So let me try to simplify, you know, what Jairaj said to solve your specific question. It may relate an experiment I did when I was responsible for Google products in India. We just took the best YouTube videos that were applicable for every class and subject for the CBSE syllabus. We collaborated with TFI, Teach for India, and we had TFI fellows use tablets and just show those videos to kids and then teach whatever they were. And it's not because of YouTube, it is because of the combination of, you know, visual online content. I mean, all of the pedagogy professors in this room did know that if you read something, your retention is 10%. If you write, it is 20-30%. If you visualize, it's like 60%. If you discover, it's 90%, right? Long story short, what we found was when we did side-by-side studies in the same area, two different TFI fellows in two different classrooms, one with the content, one without the content, we had a 60% jump. 60% jump in outcome and improvement. So my mantra is very simple. Make sure you have very high quality bandwidth coming into the school, because
without bandwidth, tablets don't work, none of this works. Right? Two, make sure you have at least one master teacher. And I'm saying only one. One is enough because the one can help the others. Right? And then you empower the teacher to modify the classrooms with whatever content system you use. Hopefully, we'll try one of these, but it can be just YouTube videos. Doesn't matter. So, those three steps, if you take, I think, with the existing infrastructure, the key is to get that one master teacher in a government school. So, that has to be via grant or some other place.
So, I think we have to close this down. I'm sorry, there are some hands up there. I just want to say that we are convinced that there is tremendous potential. These youngsters have begun with having an impact. They're going to go much further. I'm sure you'd like to chat with them offline. And I have learned a lot from these three youngsters and Lalitesh and other folks, because I'm very interested in what this sector, the startup world, can do for having social impact. I think there's tremendous potential. And for those of you who have interest in starting companies in India, they can also perhaps share information about their journey. They've been through angel funding, they've been through CSA, Million Bucks, and so on. So, and all the trials and tribulations, the challenges of raising funds and negotiating with investors. So there's a whole lot of information in their heads, which you're welcome to try and get from them. And of course, Lalitesh is an old timer in the sense of having successfully started Google Maps, and he's doing some fascinating work right now. He's building a platform for platforms. So tomorrow, if you want to create the next Amazon or Flipkart, and you're wondering where do I get the tech support, he's going to give you a platform in which you can set up your company without having the techies. If you take care of all the techie stuff. So he's working with London, Nilikani, and the Tatars on a company called, this is not a secret, right? Okay, Avanti, which is going to be focusing on financial inclusion. So there's a lot of talent up here. You're welcome to contact them, but now lunch is waiting. So let's just thank our panelists and thank you.